yeah, I'm Jackson. I have zero experience with carpentry.
I studied at a school for historic preservation in Boston and learned about how things were built, you know, 250 years ago.
There's a long way to go. I'm nowhere near the top. Not that I thought I was, but there's so much more to do out there.
Welcome back to the Passion for Craft podcast episode. Today we're talking about neoclassicism, the one classicism. Go ahead.
So
the matrix.
Neoclassicism can be, the reason we're talking about this is because it can be confusing, because there is a neoclassicism in after the Georgian period, going into the federal period, a kind of a new classicism. So by definition, neoclassicism is new classicism, right? And so, and then you have another neoclassicism around the turn of the century, 1900s, as McKean, Mead, and White and a bunch of those guys reintroduced classicism. And so
would you consider yourself a neoclassicist as well in the modern day? Because you're reintroducing classicism in a lot of ways?
Yes, maybe.
Kind of cool.
Yeah, kind of cool. So this it comes up because we'll talk about Thistle Hill, which we're doing a restoration there now. And we say, or the Kell House up in Wichita Falls that we did before that.
I didn't even recognize Thistle Hill.
You'd say it's neoclassical. Okay, well, why would you say it's neoclassical? Well, because it is a, you know, temple front without the pediment. You know, you've got the strong emphasis of the columns, the entablature, and it's that classical style, right? Now, let's put this in context real quick. So you've got, you know, Georgian, Federal, Greek Revival, okay? Georgian, Federal, and Greek Revival are all classical, okay? Inspired from different things. And then we go into Victorian, Gothic Revival, Second Empire, you know, Queen Anne, all that Gothic stuff. Then you go into arts and crafts, okay? And then you go into period revival and then modernism. Now, what happens right at the end of the Victorian era in the 1890s to 1910, which was when McKean, Mead, and White, those architects in New York, started doing put their architecture firm together, is they started practicing classicism again. Okay, so if you think of a Queen Anne house like McFarland House here in Fort Worth, which is this, you know, a mix of all these French, and you got turrets and you've got, you know, all these different things going on there, this real eclectic blend of all these different styles, right? That's chateau-esque, it's you know, it's French, it's all these different things. There's
that house is awesome.
There's classical elements there in that there's a column and a pedestal, but it's not like Thistle Hill. It's not this stronger classicism where the you know, that strong temple, you know, front coming out, mm-hmm, is dominant, right? And so
wait, what house was that other one? That was sick. I've never seen that one before.
That's McFarland. That's right over here on Penn Street.
Come on, man.
Yeah.
Come on, man. Pick your game up.
My bad. That's awesome. I really like that house. It's kind of quirky and fun.
So that's crazy. So again, Georgian, okay, and there's two classicisms. So there's the neoclassicism that is discovered by Robert Adam in Pompeii and all the things that are going there. It was a new classicism, okay? When they were inspired, when the Grand Tour guys were inspired by Italy and Rome, mm-hmm, okay? They went back and designed their buildings based on the exterior of these buildings, okay? So Georgian houses tend to be very strong and heft and bold and thick and everything else. Robert Adam discovers Pompeii, okay? Mm-hmm. Pompeii was being excavated. Pompeii was the Roman city that was basically covered in ashes by the Herculaneum volcano, basically froze everything in time for 2,000 years, okay? When they started excavating it, they found it because the king of Naples was going to build him a palace, and they discovered this city underneath everything, and they started digging away. Well, you can imagine.
No way.
Imagine if America right now, or if Fort Worth, Texas, just got covered in dust, and then because of time and everything, got forgotten for 2,000 years, and then got rediscovered. Imagine the treasure hunters that would come here and the things that they would be trying to find.
Well, Bass Hall.
That's what was going on, yeah, at Pompeii. Is they were trying, they began to rediscover this. And what they discovered as a part, as well as all the treasures and everything, was that this was what the real Roman interior looked like.
No
way. And they were like, wait a minute, it's not this way. It's not like the exterior of their buildings. It's very different. And so there's all this color and there's all this decoration, mm-hmm. and things are light and dainty. And look at the motifs and the other things that they were using for design elements. That's what our new interior should look like.
So was this found as a result of, like, is this a photo that was preserved?
So that why they did the neoclassicism, the new classicism, is they rediscovered what classical world looked like in reality. Now, what was your question?
I don't think it mattered. Wait, before or after. No, it matters. How did they figure this out? How did they, like, did they find, like, is this a drawing of a room that they found? Yes. So they, like, dug in and were like, oh, cool. That had blue on it.
They found it. This is...
Did they find the picture? Okay, that's what it looks like. Right? Okay,
that's
cool.
That's a room.
They found it with color like that?
Yeah.
That is crazy.
And what?
Because of volcanic ash.
And it was that crazy color, okay? Bright, brilliant colors, mm-hmm. okay? That made them go, oh, so...
Oh, my gosh.
That's the interior of a Pompeii. So that's a Pompeian interior.
But do we think, so looking at like nowadays versus then, and not to bash, you know, your favorite people, the Romans, but this looks like, in downtown Fort Worth, some of the buildings have painted on mm-hmm. exteriors.
Trompe l'oeil.
This looks, yeah, trompe l'oeil. Yeah, this looks trompe l'oeil.
Donald's cousin,
yeah.
Well, it certainly understood the perspective, right? And they did that thing.
But I'm asking, like, drawn on instead of them actually having columns on the inside.
I don't look at it as good or bad. Uh-huh. I mean, because it's done so cheesily mm-hmm. today, I don't look at it positively.
Yeah.
But when I see the way it was done historically, I have an appreciation for it. But we don't have good examples of it, so it makes us go, well, it's kind of cheesy.
Yeah, yeah.
Because a lot of customers want, you know, cherubs on their ceilings and do cheesy things like paint their dog and their kid up on the ceiling.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
You're just like, and the perspective and the drawings aren't very good. And so you're just like, yeah. I remember we did a house where they painted a wall, they did a hand painted wallpaper thing. So they spent $20,000 or $30,000 on a custom hand painted wall, but it was just terrible. The proportions were bad. The perspective was bad. The house as it was redrawn was bad. It was just like, ugh. Anyway.
But the goal of this was just to make it feel bigger on the inside without actually having the square footage, right?
I don't know if that, you know, to throw all your square footage, price per square foot stuff out the window. We don't think that that's how really they thought about building back then. And so we believe purely an effort on their part to create a beautiful interior.
Cool.
Now, they might have been looking at Egyptian models. They might have been looking at Greek models. They might have been looking at who knows where their inspiration came from. Mm-hmm. But this is what they did. Now, next slide.
Really quick, do you guys remember this building in Fort Worth?
Oh, yeah.
No.
Right next to the courthouse.
Yes. It was fake? It was drawn on?
Uh-huh.
No.
They did that during the same period they were redoing downtown.
Trompe l'oeil.
But without that decoration and drawing on there, that building was an ugly, ugly building. So Robert Adam, goes to Pompeii. This is the kind of house that he started designing, okay?
That's cool.
Well, it's crazy. Right? I mean,
you're crazy.
Look at those colors. You got lime green, you got pink, like bubblegum pink.
Mm-hmm.
You got, you know, that sky blue.
I thought it was just red. I thought it was just the screen. That's bubble. Okay, I'm seeing the real colors.
You're seeing the real colors.
I've been giving a little bit of grace here. Okay. I thought it was like a nice light blue and then a nice solid red.
But you'll still see like designers now, like they'll use quirky, funky colors.
Yeah.
There's like a whole style behind that.
But look at in the column on the left, right? That decoration and that kind of that light, dainty drawing.
I think it looks good on the ceiling. I don't think it looks good on the column.
Look, I mean, I look at this and go, wow, that's way too much. I mean, are you kidding me? But I say that back to our point of topic. This is neoclassicism, right? So the federal period, the Adamesque period in England, it is neoclassical because of the new discoveries that were going on. Now, Greek Revival comes along, and Greek Revival is inspired because of the new of the Greek War of Independence, because we're the Ottoman Turks are letting Americans travel into Greece, and we can actually look at Greece, letting people into Greece. And so, you know, Greece gets their independence, and we have this whole Greek Revival movement.
Yeah.
Then you go from probably 1850 until about 1890, where it's all Victorian. Second Empire, Queen Anne, all the just crazy Victorian stuff. And so they forget about the classical period, because if you think of Georgian Federal and Greek Revival are all very classical, okay, inspired from the Greeks and the Romans. The Victorian period is inspired from French, Egyptian, Gothic, everything, right? It's an amalgamation of everything. McKean, Mead, and White, okay, as an architectural firm, begin to redraw things. So the Pantheon, which is the most famous architectural, you know, building in Rome, okay, the Parthenon is the temple in Greece. The Pantheon is the temple in Rome.
Yeah.
It is this building, okay,
yeah,
with that pedimented form and the round dome, okay? They began to do this over and over again. Monticello is based on this form. Dallas Hall at SMU is based on that form.
Yep.
MIT has a building like that. Mm-hmm. And so who was doing all that? McKean, Mead, and White. They were the ones that start this neoclassicism again in the early 1900s, okay? And so you see these kind of buildings where these classical forms are reintroduced. And so the Kell House, Thistle Hill, and look at some of those other houses that were on Quality Hill next to Thistle Hill. I mean, that's a neoclassical house. Look at that temple front coming out from that thing, right?
Even look at that water tower, just all out of brick.
And that's gone, right?
It's gone.
Yeah.
It's been torn down. And there's other houses, right? I mean, over and over again, we see this temple form, this neoclassicism is what I'm calling it, right? Happening again. And so the point of this talk was to try to clear up the confusion between neoclassicism and neoclassicism.
Thanks for really clearing that one.
And so, you know, and today, as Jackson was alluding to, we're kind of relearning the classical language and stuff like that. So is it a neoclassicism again, 100 years later? Maybe. I'm not sure yet, but
yes. I'm right.
You don't have major house forms with things like this.
Aren't you building major house forms?
I'm a lonely voice in the desert.
Does it have to start with one? You're referencing McKean, Mead, and White, and you're referencing Robert Adams. Like, you know, you're referencing these one-offs.
Any case.
Maybe.
That's flattering.
Okay, humble guy.
To think that you're saying that, but that's not really accurate. Nope. So, I was at a board meeting yesterday, and they're talking about just kind of purpose in life. And one of the purposes I feel is that, and God has placed me here to make architecture beautiful. Okay. Weird thing. And so what I started doing was building. Okay. If someone wanted to be a master builder, someone said to me the other day, instead of doing one-on-ones consulting, you ought to do like one-on-10 and one-on-20 and invite people into, you know, conferences where if I had a one-day conference, okay, building conference, and, you know, would anybody show up if I walked them through, you know, a bunch of different things? So what would I walk them through? If I look at my career, my life, you know, I had kind of three different areas of expertise that I had to learn. There's the preservation piece, like, you know, this historical, you know, how was it built? What was the historical method of doing it? What was the preservation? How would I rebuild that today? Okay. Then there was about a 10-year period of classicism where I was learning, you know, how the columns goes together with the entablature and what those even words are and stuff like that. And then the last 10 years, it's been the build science piece, right? Just learning this thing. Now, so there's three areas of building expertise that I think I could teach on. There's the other piece of it, though, is the hard and soft skills of, you know, managing people, talking to clients, doing sales, portfolio, which we talked about, you know, the marketing piece, you know, how are you wired? How are you bent? And so I would love it if there was like a group of questions that you could send them, and they fill out these surveys. You figure out what personality style they are. You figure out kind of where they're gifted and things like that. Mm-hmm. And then you have, you know, an hour long thing where you sit down with them, and say, you know, tell me what's going on with your business. Tell me, you know, what things you're struggling with. Hey, this is who you are. This is the kind of person you need to help or find to help you, you know, get better. Because there's like, I'm passionate and I care a lot about the details, but I'm not a numbers person. And so there's going to be guys that are going to be numbers guys that aren't, don't care about beauty that much. And so fleshing out a team so that you can do well, but also giving them the information and having them bring plans and really make it valuable time so everybody can learn. And so it's just the question to me, the question in my mind is the reason I was bringing that up is because I feel like in that first section, that historical section, there is a understanding of architectural styles in America that I had to learn, and it took me a long time to learn. And I think it's something people need to, like you guys looking at that and say, well, what style is that? And almost pulling up any style today, right? There is no style, okay? And so there's a lot of copies of past things, but you know, most houses built after 1960 have no style. Mm-hmm. Maybe they're ranch, right? Maybe they're strong, like my house built in 62, it's not really strongly anything, okay? It isn't even strongly ranch. It's a low long house with a low pitched roof. That's about the only way it's ranch.
Maybe bushcraft.
And so
just more
a little bit of bushcraft
function. Bushcraft, yeah.
So we're going back to and talking about neoclassicism, stuff like that. But the fact is there is no style today. And I think that is a fascinating, you know, cultural statement about that we build things that aren't any darn, they haven't been designed. Mm-hmm. We're building things that have just been assembled.
I jokingly said that bushcraft comment, but I was kind of serious. Like when you think of those bushcraft guys, just, well, let's make a structure. I kind of feel like that's how our houses are now.
I couldn't agree more.
Just make a structure.
Well, I did a video on building from the inside out, that the way houses are designed today, some says, well, I need a big kitchen and I want an informal living. Oh, and I need my master, but I want it separated from the kids' rooms, and you know, and we need a library. Okay. And so the architect just, you know, grabbing these parts and pieces, and then
yeah, it's like a logic puzzle too. It's like Jenny is friends with Beth, but can't be friends with Anne. It has to be, and you're like, okay, so they want it detached, but they want this informal.
And so, but what happens is you design the floor plan first, and then they go, what style do you want? Well, something traditional, or, you know, and so all of a sudden this form grows up out of the ground, and it's just like, wait a minute, what even is that?
Like,
so
a monster.
Where's the front door? What's going on? Why is there no organization? Why hasn't this been put together well? Well, the reason we have ugly houses today, because we've forgotten how to do that. Mm-hmm. And so it's crazy to me that we're building houses that have no style.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Totally.
It's frustrating.
All the time.
Well, yeah, I'm just so confused. Like, I would love, I just hear you talking about, like, people don't know how to identify the styles today. And one of my new employee, he's really big into the Passion for Craft podcast. He's been loving it. But he'll text me randomly and go, what style is this? What is this? Like, is this a good house and all this stuff? And I'm like, I wish there was like a flashcard set out there that would be like, what style is this house? Well, it's this. And then you flip it over and you're like, it's this because this.
Oh, that would be.
Like, I think that would be so helpful.
That would be awesome. Because
I'm trying to figure it out right now. Same. And like, just gave me the book, whatever, for my birthday last year. Yeah, it's Field Guide to American Houses.
Virginia McAllister, it's a must have.
I've been reading it and it's been awesome because I'm like, oh, I know to look for this shape when I'm talking about this house. And like, I'm making flashcards currently like for me.
But it's hard to, even for me, like a lot of people send me, what style is this? What is this? Mm-hmm. And a lot of times you have to go, you know, tilting your head, kind of going, well, I guess I need to know a few more facts because sometimes you just can't tell.
Yeah.
Like, well, when was it built? Right. And sometimes that'll help you, you know, wrap around when it's supposed to be, but it's hard to do.
Yeah. And it's
confusing. Yeah.
Especially if it's, I mean, you already said like the houses we build are like the early American crap period, you know, like, I mean, really, like, what do you call this style? No style.
Early
like,
American crap.
Yeah. It's
I don't know.
Yeah. No, it's culturally, it's a problem. And it would be great if there was, if we could go back to a neoclassicism. The problem is, the neoclassical houses that are built today are a mess. I just did my Wednesday video this last week, and I was driving through Highland Park on the way home from a job that we just finished. And I just had to stop the car and take pictures. I was just like, what in the world? And people send in these design videos and they can't get the columns right. They can't get the columns right on $1 million houses, $3, $5, $8 million houses. And they've got these classical elements that are just a
joke.
They're, that's a nice way of saying it. They're just ill-informed, right? They're just not executed very well. They're not designed very well, if they even have been designed.
Well, that's the other question about it. Like, to, I mean, okay, so practically you're a builder, right? And you have a client who's gives you the logic puzzle of, I want this, but not that, this and not that. And then you're wanting to imprint your design on it because you're like, this is my work. I want to make sure I'm proud of it. And then the client's like, I want these set of things. How do you practically go about doing that? Do you start with the outside of the house and go, hey, this is what your house is going to look like? Or this is, here are some options for what your house could look like. Then taking that, if this is what your house is going to look like, here's the two floor plans if you're doing a two-story home. And you've got your bottom floor, which you can put, and then you like kind of play with it there.
You are logically putting together the way it should work. Mm-hmm. Okay. Oftentimes, well, I don't see it happening very much. I don't think there is the knowledge of the architects and designers that are doing this house that would understand that if you really want to do a ranch house, it's probably not two story. You know, if you want to do the historical, you know, Western California, Texas ranch house with the low slung roofs and the layout with the courtyards and things like that. There's not many architects or designers who go, okay, well, if we're going to do that form, you know, it's going to be hard to sell a second floor on that thing. Oh, okay. Right. Or, you know, if I want something, you know, asymmetrical, okay, then you're probably talking more of a cottage, right? Than something that is very formal and ordered and laid out and organized on the facade. We're not talking about that. And so, you know, then understanding all of the details that go along with a cottage versus a classical house or a more refined house. And I mean, the perfect example is the eave detail on a lot of these new houses will be a rustic house with timbering and the things, and then this framed eave detail with the closed soffit and moldings. And I'm like, how can you have a timbered house here and a box soffit with the return on a gable end? Yeah. What are you doing? Yeah. You can't. Those don't go together. So they don't understand all the parts and pieces that go together towards that historical style. So we're practicing designing without understanding all the parts and pieces that go into it. Our houses don't make sense.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
It does make sense how definitely. They don't make sense. curiously, like, you know, one thing I just keep thinking about is if you gave me a list of like hard and fasts of like ranch style home cannot be two stories. Like, or ranch style home must have this, can't have this. If you gave me a list of all the styles of houses, I could put together a program that would go, do you want this on your house? This on your house. And people could literally go and click all the things they want to have on their house. And then you'd go, we're building a ranch style house.
You know, it'd be crazy.
House or whatever house.
I bet there's some Frankenstein, you know, potato head looking weird things that would come out of that.
Well, definitely. That would come out of that for sure. But I'm saying like they would come back with a word result of like your house can't exist or.
Well, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's very well. It's needed. Okay. Yeah. It's because we'll have people come to us and say, I want a Spanish colonial house. Okay. Well,
what do you mean by that?
What do you mean by that? Right. What does that mean to you? Why are you using those words?
Yeah.
And
who,
you know,
told you these words?
Yeah. Pretty much.
It's like a toddler. Where'd you hear that?
You don't say that again. You understand?
And so the
Spanish colonial, the two-story ranch.
Are you done?
I had one more.
I lost it.
Really? You were saying that they will come to you with Mr. Potato Head style.
Oh, yeah. So realize that because no one really knows what Spanish colonial is. Like, so Spanish colonial, what would that be? Okay, that would be a colony, okay, that Spain originally settled, right? Maybe in the Caribbean, right? Mm-hmm. If they took one of the islands there, that would be Spanish colonialism, okay? Mm-hmm. So it would be, right, by definitions of the word.
Right.
But, you know, so in my mind, that would be a rustic, simplified, Spanish detailing, right? Because they would have had to take local stone, local materials, local craftsmen to try to rebuild the great things they were doing in Spain. They never would have gotten it quite right because they didn't have the craftsmanship. They didn't have the architects. It was just unsophisticated. Instead, it was, you know, merchants and things like that moving to that area saying, I want it to reflect Spain. And so it kind of would, but it really wouldn't. So mm-hmm. that's by definition what Spanish colonial is. Now, if I said all that in front of the client who just said, I want a Spanish colonial, yeah, no, that's not what I want.
And well, they would also go, but you know, that's not what I mean.
Right.
They would go, I really mean, I want like a, you know, barrel roof tiles, but I want big columns on the front or something.
Or something. And so, you know, the fact that we are all using a language that we really don't know what it means.
Yeah, it's,
right?
There's no definite.
It's just all these random words. And, you know,
hey, YouTube guys, that'd be a great YouTube video. That would get a ton of views. Like,
what are you talking about?
Modern architectural language. Like, just simplify, like, home buyer's guide to architectural language. And you just make a video series of, like, here are house styles. This is what this means. This is what this means.
I've my friends at AIM Media, Peter Miller, that does Old House Journal and all those different magazines, says the number one question they get is house styles.
Mm-hmm.
And so it is.
There you go. Yeah. That'd be a good video.
It is very, but the problem is.
I don't know. It'd have to be him.
The problem is.
I'm one of the ones who wrote in.
It's this soup of words. Okay.
Yeah.
And if we just said, okay, let's take out all the classical stuff. Pilasters, entablatures, architrave, you know, put it over there. That's all classical. Well, those things are also used in Spanish colonialism, mm-hmm. right? And so, you know, oh, okay. That, well, so I got to put that.
I don't think the video is that necessarily. And like, if you get there faster, good luck. But what I'm saying is like the video could very well be like, today we're talking about what is a Mediterranean home. All right, here are some things that are typical in a Mediterranean home.
That's
these type
a good
of windows,
video.
This type of plaster, this type of thing. Like, this is what you'll see commonly referred to.
You hearing that, Austin? You like that idea?
I like that a lot.
And then you go, these are some things that are typical in a colonial style home. But you would even go like more, like you go as broad as possible and you say, here's some other names you might hear for Victorian. Queen Anne, this name, this thing, this thing. These are the things. And then at the end of the video, you do a too long, didn't read. So overview, Victorian, fancy, lot of decor, lot of this. Queen Anne, specifically this. This thing, specifically this.
So my next buildings and brews were going to be a deep dive into the different architectural styles.
That would be helpful.
English Tudor and then Mediterranean. Because think about Mediterranean. Why is it called Mediterranean? Because it's on the Mediterranean, okay? Well, you got Spanish Mediterranean, you got French Mediterranean, you got Italian Mediterranean, Greece. You got Greek Mediterranean. Yeah. So you got all these different Mediterranean things. You know, what do they have in common? What's going on there? So anyway, there's a lot of good, interesting stuff there, you know.
But I think you should make those videos. I really think those videos would be solid. Like the problem right now, what you keep saying is the problem is no one has a language for it. And it's literally like you're saying no one knows how to build good houses right now. It's like, well, the perfect thing for a company would do is to go in and build good houses. It's like, that's the same kind of problem.
So, you know, it all started, okay, and we're going to look at a bunch of houses here in a second. But it all started in the Victorian period, because the Victorian period, they, you know, the first McMansions were Victorian houses, okay?
Really?
Oh, for sure. Because you got these eclectic, yes, weird conglomerate. Even when we were looking at McFarland, it is a weird collection of parts and pieces. Okay,
but it works, right?
Well, I mean,
there might be a clip of me in another episode. I think we've shown this before. There might be a clip of me in another episode going, "Oh, I hate that."
I like it today. So, what's the difference between a McMansion and this house? Okay, well.
I think this is built good.
Yeah, the materials, right, are really well done. I mean, it's sandstone. It's all cut and custom made sandstone. You've got copper and copper detailing. And look at those brackets.
Well,
yeah, copper
still looks the good. Proportions are right.
The proportions are right.
Yeah,
right.
That's
the
true.
The relationship between the column and the pedestal and the balustrade. All of those things are
even the slope of the roof and
better.
Everything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So looks really you know, good. There's a lot of stuff in that. That, you know, it's a beautiful. There's a lot of beautiful details now.
But at the same time, it's
but at
like
the same time, what style is that? Right? Yeah. Well,
Victorian.
Like that dormer window sticking out as a French, you know, chateau-esque, you know, lit looking thing. And you could flash to chateaus that have that almost exact dormer, you know, thing sticking out of it. So the proportions are really good. Look how small those windows are in that dormer. If you ever heard me talking about dormers, that the windows are
you
too
want a
big.
Lot
and so,
of windows in dorm.
So anyway, so but it starts. You know that McMansionism starts here because it's consumer led. Okay, it is used in a lot of house plan books, and you end up seeing a mismatch of styles. That kind of come together.
Is okay. Is it bad that I like that style? Because that style is sick, in my opinion.
No, I mean, I've always been attracted to this house, and I've always thought it's interesting. But the more I stare at it, like that bracket, sitting out there holding up that roof. That's weird, in my opinion.
Holding up the roof or the chimney? Which one?
Holding up the roof
above the
on
entry?
The right side above the entry.
Oh.
Or above
no,
one.
Above,
or
keep up going to the left. Yeah.
Keep going higher to the left.
Left, right,
right there.
There.
No,
that,
down.
That bracket,
down,
that
right
pink
there.
Thing, yeah.
Yeah, that is a stone. First of all, stone can't support like that.
That's the only thing that I see, though, that I'm like, that's kind of odd. Because if that window just came out a little bit more, if it was like an even come out and it just had a rectangular or a whatever trapezoidal thing underneath,
well,
I think it'd look great.
I don't like how the pedestal on the porch sits up so much higher than the balustrade.
Okay, that's the only other thing.
I think that hood on that porch is fat. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think it, you know, there's
looks
a lot
like
of
a UFO.
There's a lot of detail, but it looks like a UFO sitting down on that thing. So, you know.
But I also want to go sit in that gazebo. You know what I mean?
It's a very inviting house.
I'd sit
right?
there.
I've been on this porch.
It's pretty nice. Fun.
Yeah, and the brick lines are real tight.
Just look how inviting that porch is, right? That the way the arms sweep down and kind of want to invite you in.
Oh, I mean, that one's really good.
It's
the slope of that is so cool.
Yeah, no, it's really great. Okay, let's look at some of these other houses.
Big fan. Ooh.
right, there's a great example of a Victorian house that wants to be everything.
Yeah, it wants to be a castle.
Look at the castle
right.
on the right. Right,
it wants to be a temple, a Taj Mahal.
And this is why
left.
This is why I was saying that the that these are the early McMansions.
It's like Russian.
Because this
building.
Yeah, this looks like a
Taj Mahal.
have you seen the?
Some
if you've ever driven up by the Windstar, right?
Yeah.
Oh,
they,
yeah.
They have,
yeah.
You know, they have Italy. They have Florence. They have, you know, Rome. They have
the
Colosseum all across the facade.
That.
That's what that looks like.
That's
and so, it's just kind of a mess.
This looks like the first ever modern home. It also looks exactly like Thistle Hill
it
in the layout.
Does.
I mean,
it
this
looks like a modern Thistle Hill.
Yeah. It does.
It looks
it
like
does.
Some AI generated
it's,
Thistle
it's
Hill.
It's very. I mean, this one's more stoic than the other
yes.
one, right? Mm-hmm. The other one was all over the place. This one is more serious, right? And so there's not the decoration is contained to a few brackets or something like that at the top mm-hmm. in the eave. But
these were all around Thistle Hill.
Mm-hmm.
That's sad.
Isn't that crazy?
Because despite that other one having like Taj Mahal features and stuff, I still want to see it.
Yeah.
That would have been cool.
Wow, that's crazy. They tore all these down.
Yeah.
Oh man, that's
now this is interesting. Yes, that's a good word.
It's like a bank in the middle.
It does look like a commercial building. I think that, you know, there's some Beaux-Arts, which is that French classicism stuff with those
bizarre.
But it's also it's long and low, more like the arts and crafts, more mm-hmm. like, you know, that kind of at first glance at this I thought it was arts and crafts. But it's it looks like a commercial building, but got, except like, for that sleeping porch up on the left.
Yeah, now it's cool.
It's interesting.
Critch, come on over to Critch Antiques.
So this is a, and you can sit here, you can watch me sit here and go, okay, what is
that? And that's the kind of the point, right?
Yeah,
it's like, what is it?
So this is kind of a four square body, right? And then you got that little porch over there to your left. But that, I mean, that without the thing on the left, that's a typical four square house.
The soffit is gigantic.
Yeah,
right,
you've got the, those large brackets that give that overhanging soffit. But
that dormer looks crazy.
Do we think the side of the house was added on later? Impossible to know now. It's torn down.
Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting. I suspect that was an open air porch that they closed in later.
Yeah, because look at the roof line. It just looks to every other roof line is completely enclosed.
What is that video game where you have the little mushroom guy?
Yeah, that's Mario.
That's what that thing looks like at the top.
Yeah, it does.
That's
it does.
A Goomba. There are Goombas in Mario.
Yeah, that's what that looks about. Like. Yeah. Did you think that, Austin?
He's laughing because you didn't know it, Mario.
That is the video game. If there was a video game, that is like the one. Also, because there's 30,
I'm glad I didn't know that.
Are you?
This one's odd too.
It has like Tudor influence with the boards and right.
Yeah, like, and that like that dormer doesn't work for me at all. And that is a weird looking dormer.
What's a dormer again? If you guys wouldn't remind me,
or for the audience, you know, we'll tell the audience.
Yeah, for them.
It's the windows coming out of the roof.
Yeah.
Whenever there's
something on the roof. But see, they've got a clipped gabled end. Okay. So that little.
So instead of a pork chop end, instead of a gabled end return, they've got a clipped gable.
On the far right, instead of that gable going up like this.
Yeah.
Okay.
I see. The top. Okay.
The top of it is kind of is angled down. It's called a clipped dormer.
It's like they did origami on the roof.
They've done the same thing on that dormer, but it's. I don't think it's successful.
It kind of looks fine over here, but over there, it kind of makes it look weird.
Yeah, it's I would say that this is not a successful house.
Isn't that like clipped gabled in, just a hearkening back to like the Cotswolds kind of style?
It's a cottage element. Cottage
I love
detail.
The cottage.
So, yeah.
Ooh, oh.
Kind of like that.
Mm-hmm. With the swerved window?
Yeah, that little porch
the
inside.
The protractor
that,
on the
porch there,
side of the wall,
the
those two windows cool. Like that bathroom window on the far left and then the full-size window right next to it looks pretty odd. It looks like there's a door and a window.
Yeah, I know,
it's
quirky
off.
Right. This is a gambrel roof. Okay, the gambrel is that barn. It is, there's two pitches. There's the lower pitch and then there's an upper pitch. So that's
what's the name of it again?
Gambrel. It's like that barn. And so this kind of looks like a barn that's been adapted. But yeah, that's, I mean, to me, this is where that other house was unsuccessful. You know, this house is very interesting and intriguing. And is, you know, the fact that I kind of want to sit here and look at it for a while. I think, you know, it's a very interesting, cool house.
I don't. Yuck.
You don't like it?
No, I really don't. Hmm. And I actually like cottage style homes. So that was kind of shocking. And barns, like barn does.
So,
that thing's weird on the ornament at the very top.
Yeah, it feels like that's the biggest thing in this one is like, what the heck are they
like
doing
that
ornament?
Like that just needs to come down and it would look.
Well,
so there's the mission front, okay?
Oh, yeah.
So, right? You've got mission, but you've also got a classical swag there.
Was the Alamo a mission? Because it has that mission front, yeah.
And so, right, that's that maybe Mediterranean, maybe certainly Spanish, you know, top there, mm-hmm. but the French way of dressing those swags over that window is a disconnect, right? And mm-hmm. so it's just a,
yeah,
it's a disconnect. And so I think it's an interesting house. I don't think it's a great house.
Thanks for helping me with that Alamo thing. I couldn't remember. This one, honestly, the exposure is doing this one dirty a little bit, you know, like you can't see the full roof because clearly there's something that's up there.
Yeah. Well, so,
but the columns on the front has got my goat there. That one's a little weird.
This one looks like the workmen are finishing up the house and they're pretty proud of themselves. They're getting their picture taken.
And they shouldn't be.
They've got the dirt.
Yeah, because look at
the dirt still in the front.
Yeah, good eye.
Maybe scaffolding on that porch. It
looks like they've still got where they're setting the concrete on the front left.
But I mean, you know, this has that, you know, neoclassical front, but it's
I mean, again, it looks like a bank front.
Yeah, I don't know what style that is, right? I think I know what period it is, but mm-hmm. I don't know what style it is, and I think that style confusion, you know, starts during that Victorian period when things are, you know, undefinable.
Okay, little St. Peter's action right here.
So the little tower on the right with this, so that they would make it want to be, the tower is, you know, sometimes Italianate, but that one's not really done that way. This reads Byzantine to me.
Kind of look like a Russian or kind of, what is it?
Well, the Russian would be the olive, the onion top thing, and which I can see why you're thinking
see the,
that.
See the top left one?
Uh-huh.
That one looks kind of oniony. I know it's not. It kind of swerps out, but it's.
But this is, you know, late Victorian, kind of a, you know, odd collection of different details. But anyway, the point is that all those houses, right, where there's you know, there's a reason why people, it's confusing. There's a reason why we started with the neoclassical, and because neoclassicism happens at a number of different times, and so it becomes confusing when we're sitting there trying to figure out, like, what's the Kell House? What style is that?
The White House is neoclassical, right? Is that?
He did say that. He said that at one point. I remember that episode well.
I mean, because we were trying
no style, technically.
It's neoclassical because of the period it was built in, right? It was after the Revolutionary War. Neoclassicism and federal style starts, after that period. But I wouldn't characterize that house as being neoclassical. It's much more Palladian, okay. Mm. Which would make sense for James Hoban, who is the Irish architect who came over here and won that competition. But the
an Irish architect.
Yes,
they're rare.
So anyway, but neoclassical and again confusion is built during that neoclassical era. First neoclassical era, federal style, but it's not federal style. It's Palladian.
Do you like buildings that are more like in, like, say, like a pure Georgian building? Or, like, I know you like Thistle Hill, but what do you prefer? Like a neoclassical?
I think one of my favorite places to be architecturally is the UVA campus on the lawn. Okay. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. And that's a bunch of, you know, early 1800s, Jeffersonian and Palladian buildings. And I've said in one of my talks that some of those houses look very Greek Revival, and someone got on me about that. But I know they weren't built in the Greek Revival period, but they are in that style. Mm. And so I tend to like that. I think my favorite style is Greek Revival. I think it's in a very American style, the way we interpreted it.
But you like style that doesn't stray from because all this stuff is like, well, it has this element.
Yeah.
Or do you like more of a pure form?
Well, I guess I like successful projects. I think I could do either one as long as it's executed well. Like, I don't think McFarland is
bad or anything.
Bad, yeah. Right? It's a mixed match of styles. Mm-hmm. But I think it works.
Yeah, I feel like what I've kind of learned recently, I guess, is just that there's not really... There's rules in architecture, obviously, but at the end of the day, if you think something looks good and you end up doing it and it works out,
yeah,
I mean, what more can you really ask for?
Right.
So, yeah,
mm-hmm. I agree.
Well, cool. Well, I mean, that surely didn't settle too much of the neoclassicism confusion, but it definitely settled a lot of it. I now know what neoclassicism is.
I'm actually more confused now. No, I'm just kidding. No, I'm joking.
Well, thank you guys for watching this episode of the Passion for Craft podcast. Let us know if you'd like to see a video made on what the different styles of houses are in the comments below. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.